A very good morning to all. Looking at important keywords which come up in current affairs in the Hindu newspaper for 12th May 2020. So these are the important keywords. First one is regarding Arogya Setu app. So now the protocol for it has been released. So this is for data access and knowledge sharing. So there were privacy concerns raised regarding Arogya Setu app, how it collects data and how it would be shared with which organizations, till what time would it be retained. So these concerns are being addressed in this protocol. It lays down the details regarding it. Then next is Swasth Vayu. So this is a portable ventilator which has been developed by NAL, National Aeronautics Limited, which is a CSIR organization. And this can be used for non-serious patients suffering from COVID-19, who do not require ICU, but they require oxygen supply. So this is Swasth Vayu, which has been developed. Then next is regarding internet curbs in Jammu and Kashmir. So presently now Supreme Court has set up a panel to look into this matter, because again 4G internet has been curbed, 2G internet speed has been provided here. So there are concerns being raised. It is said even in the fight against COVID-19, in hospitalization, medication also, concerns are arising. Then next is regarding larger issues of religious freedom. So this was linked to the Sabarimala case. So you should know entire background regarding Sabarimala case. Supreme Court had given its verdict in October 2018. But then later in 2019, when a review petition was filed, though the verdict was not stayed, verdict was that women should be allowed entry, women in menstruating age should be allowed entry into the Sabarimala temple in Kerala. But the implementation of that act, that court ruling did not take place, because it was seen that external forces actually stopped women from entering. So that was the problem seen. So because the ruling could not be implemented, a review petition was also filed, and review petition will be heard. But Supreme Court referred larger issue of religious freedom, that to what extent courts can intervene in religious matters. So this larger issue was referred to a 9-judge bench. This was a 3-judge bench which was hearing a review petition and referred this larger issue to 9-judge bench, and then it said after the larger issue is resolved, then we'll give the review petition. So concerns were raised, because this is not, there's no precedent as such, and this is not the way it functions, because a review petition is on a particular case, so it should review only that particular case. So this was under former CJI Ranjan Gogoi that this action was taken, and a 9-judge bench was reconstituted again under present Justice Bobre, CJI Justice Bobre too. And now the Supreme Court has ruled that it can, for delivery of justice, it can, even a review bench can refer the case to a larger bench. And the larger bench was also petitioned, the way case had come before it. But larger bench ruled that we'll hear the case. It dismissed those concerns. So that is there. Then next is regarding Kalapani region. So Kalapani region is actually a disputed territory between India and Nepal. It lies in Uttarakhand. Then Strait of Hormuz. Strait of Hormuz is also an important oil route as such, trade route. And here an incident recently happened in which Iranian training ship fired a missile mistakenly on its another ship as such. So Strait of Hormuz, and generally it remains in news. So it connects the Gulf of Oman as such to with Persian Gulf. So you should know about it. Then next is Kailash Mansarovar. So this is related to the Kalapani news presently. So it's actually, India is developing a link route. Kailash Mansarovar lies in Tibet region in China. So we are developing a route here which passes through this disputed territory of Kalapani region, and Nepal has raised concern regarding that. So you should know about Kailash Mansarovar too. And lastly, it is about NAM, National Agriculture Market. It's an e-NAM, Electronic National Agriculture Market, which is presently seeing rise in demand because of the lockdown. So we'll see how agriculture market can be online, because mandis are closed because of the lockdown. So you should know all about this too. So let's start with it. So here you can see these are the important headlines and from the Hindu newspaper, which we'll discuss in detail. So the first one is regarding number of cases increasing, COVID-19 cases. Nationwide, the death due to COVID-19 in the country has been 2,206. In single day, addition of 97 deaths have taken place. and in a single day, number of cases have also increased. Highest single day rise has been on 11th May of 4,213 cases. Also, apart from this, these numbers keep on coming every day. We do not need to remember every day's numbers, but yeah, as an update. And here you have Union Health Ministry announcing changes in policy. The discharge policy has been changed further. Union Health Ministry announced it, and it is that those home isolation guidelines have also been revised in the sense that if a person has very mild and is pre-symptomatic and he has gone into home isolation, like 14 days home isolation, then there's no need for testing after the end of the home isolation period for such cases. So this is the change in the discharge policy which has been announced presently. And the Health Ministry said that this announcement is based on ICMR review from lab surveillance data, that in such cases there's no need for testing. So these are very mild pre-symptomatic cases. So here you have the caseload in the country too, you can see. New cases, Maharashtra has recorded over 30% of India's new confirmed cases regularly. So, and this is day-wise data also shown. New cases in rest of the country and new cases in Maharashtra shown in red. Then next is, Modi asks states to prepare for ramping up economic activity. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi had a video conference with chief ministers, and it is said that to five chief ministers, including those of West Bengal, Telangana and Bihar, asked for extension of lockdown. And Prime Minister Narendra Modi also said that the lockdown cannot just suddenly be revoked. So there will continue to be some form or the other of lockdown even after May 17. And state governments, he insisted, should send their plans for ramping up economic activity in green zones between May 15 and 17 for consideration of the center. So center is asking states to ramp up economic activity. Also, Prime Minister Modi emphasized that the imperative now was to protect rural areas from COVID-19 pandemic, because these are largely untouched at the moment. But then even with migrant exodus, he raised concern that these areas would also have COVID-19 cases rising now. And he emphasized on principle of Jan se lekar jab tak. He said we should be ready for a new normal now, because this will be a new normal, the way we live and how a person lives will decide how the world would survive. So Jan se lekar jab tak means from an individual to the whole community. So this is a new reality which we have to plan for. Then next is Arogya Setu data protocol norms issued. So it is said that nearly 13,000 Arogya Setu app users have tested positive for COVID-19 so far, and their data has been transferred to the server for health intervention. Means government servers have their data. So this is actually concerns being raised regarding Arogya Setu's privacy policy. So now chairman of Empowered Group on Technology and Data Management, Ajay Soni, he has issued an order notifying Arogya Setu Data Access and Knowledge Sharing Protocol 2020. So it lays down guidelines for collection, processing, storage and sharing of anonymized data. So the app actually stores an encrypted signature. So when the user comes in proximity with other registered devices, an encrypted signature is stored. But this information is not pushed to the government server unless the user tests positive. Means government will not receive this information. It stays in the person's mobile. So this encrypted data for all users are stored in their devices, and they get deleted automatically in 30 days. So for 1 month, the data stays. And for those who test positive, then you know, when their data of those users who undergo tests, their data is kept for 45 days. And if they test positive, and then it is stored in the server till 60 days from the day they recover from the illness. So if a person is tested positive, then data is pushed up into the server and it stays there till the person, till 60 days, even 2 months after the person has recovered. So that's the idea. So 13,000 users have tested positive. Users of Arogya Setu app, and on the basis of this, alerts have been sent. It is said alerts to 1.4 lakh users have been sent, And it is said 9.8 crore people have downloaded the Arogya Setu app so far. So it's a contact tracing app. So basically, the purpose is that when a person downloads the app and the person tests positive, then the contact tracing can be done. So the data, location data is also there in the server, in the app. So wherever whoever has come in contact with that person, so that is contact tracing being done, and then those people are also alerted. So this is only an it's an app. It's only for smartphones. So now same service would be made available in feature phones too, has been announced. So when you download this app on sign up, every app user is assigned a unique randomized anonymous device ID. So it's a device ID. Neither your name nor your personal detail is shared with anyone. So that has been assured by the government. So location data is used. It's only in the case when the person tests positive, and it is to map the places the user visited in the past 14 days. So that's how contact tracing takes place. So testing of people and sanitization can take place to prevent further spread. So presently, the protocol which has been released also says that contact and location data will by default remain on the device on which the app is installed. Means it will remain on the user device, and it will be uploaded to the server only for the purpose of formulating or implementing appropriate health responses. So it will be contact and location data may be uploaded. So that has been clearly stated. And contact, location, and self-assessment data collected by National Informatics Center will not be retained beyond the period necessary. So data will be retained, and it will not be retained beyond the period necessary to satisfy the purpose for which it was obtained. So that is the discretion of the government. And the period, unless a specific recommendation to this effect is made, means for the period which will not ordinarily exceed beyond 180 days from the date on which data has been collected. So for 180 days means 6 months. So maximum 6 months from the date when it was collected. For this period, the data would remain on the servers, and after that also it will be permanently deleted. So that is being stated here. Demographic data of an individual means related to age, gender, etc. So demographic data of an individual collected by NIC will be retained for as long as the protocol remains in force, or if the individual requests that it be deleted. So that is also after 30 days after such request, it will be deleted. So these are the details which have been provided regarding Arogya Setu app's privacy policy. Then next is NAL makes ventilator for non-ICU COVID-19 cases. So National Aerospace Laboratories in Bengaluru has said that it has developed its version of BiPAP, which is a non-invasive breathing support device. So it's called BiPAP, non-breathing support device. So it can be used for non-critical, non-ICU cases of COVID-19. So this is using aerospace technology that now a breathing support device has been developed. This is a portable ventilator actually, BiPAP, which has been named Swasth Vayu. So it has been developed in record 36 days, it has been stated. And now the NAL is looking for public and private industries to partner with it for its production. So this is Swasth Vayu, portable ventilator. Then next is Supreme Court sets up panel to look into Jammu and Kashmir internet curbs. So this is Supreme Court order in which it has stated that Jammu and Kashmir government's order does not reveal any reason for making 4G mobile internet inaccessible across the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. So government order has snipped the internet speed to 2G. But then this is to be operating for a limited period, and the Supreme Court says in its order that there is no reason provided that why all the districts of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir are required to have such restrictions imposed on them. So this is what a point raised in the Supreme Court order, which was given by three judge bench led by Justice N.V. Ramana. So this was on the basis of petitions filed separately by media professionals, school associations, private citizens, and they claim that lack of access to high-speed internet in Jammu and Kashmir has also crippled medical efforts to contain COVID-19 contagion and has affected online education and businesses too. Government, on the other hand, it says that high-speed internet has been a facilitator of terrorism in the Union Territory, and that is why it has been cut. But internet, high-speed internet has been cut, and freedoms have been restricted in Jammu and Kashmir since August 5, when the special status of Jammu and Kashmir was revoked. So the top court has now appointed, Supreme Court has appointed a special committee led by Union Home Secretary to immediately determine the necessity of continuing the restrictions. So we had the Anuradha Bhasin judgment of January 2022, which dealt with the month-long curfew imposed in Jammu and Kashmir following dilution of Article 370. To quote, the restrictions should not be disproportionate to the emergent situation. So restrictions can be imposed, but they cannot be disproportionate restrictions. They have to be reasonable and defensible. So national security concerns and citizens' rights have to be balanced. So this is the timeline of Supreme Court ruling. You can see the curves which have been imposed on Jammu and Kashmir too. Like Article 370 was scrapped on 5th August 2019. That was communication was blacked out in Jammu and Kashmir. So then landlines were restored. Postpaid connections were functional, but only in Kupwara by September. Then postpaid mobile services throughout Kashmir was restored. So complete communication blackout was there. You can see from August to September until October. Means you cannot even call. Then you had SMS service restored. Broadband operational in government hospitals by Jan 2020. And then came 10th Jan 2020, the Anuradha Bhasin case, in which Supreme Court ordered review of curbs in Jammu and Kashmir within a week. So that's what has been a panel has been set up by presently by the Supreme Court again on 4G internet being curbed. And this is in the context of even COVID-19 pandemic, which is all, the fight against which is also affected. Then next is right to religion. Supreme Court explains reference to larger bench. So 9-judge bench of the Supreme Court declared that superior courts enjoy untrampled powers to take up any cause to do complete justice. So this declaration came in a judgment explaining why the bench 3 months ago decided to go ahead and examine larger issues of religious freedom across multiple faiths in connection with the Sabarimala review. So as we discussed in the beginning, that Sabarimala case review was being heard by a 5-judge bench in November 2019. So 5-judge bench led by the then Chief Justice of India, Ranjan Gogoi, he did not complete the task of reviewing the original Sabarimala judgment of 2018, which was, or the judgment ruling was in favor of women of every age group. They will be allowed to enter the temple and worship. But then the review was not heard. Rather, he framed larger issues concerning essential religious practices of various religions and clubbed other pending cases on the subjects as varied as female genital mutilation among Dawoodi Boras, entry of Parsi women who married interfaith into fire temple, Muslim women entering into mosques. So all these cases were clubbed together and referred to a larger bench. So this is a concern being raised now, that when the case is of review petition on particular specific case of Sabarimala, then a review bench has to give its ruling on that particular case. It cannot bring up other issues and club them together. But then the 9-judge bench had been formed, and also the successor CJ, present CJ Justice Bobre, he also set up a 9-judge bench to hear the reference. So the 9-judge bench is there, and now the 9-judge bench has ruled that they will take up the larger issue. It says the superior courts enjoy untrammeled powers to take up any cause to do complete justice. So they will hear larger religious issues. So this is there. So it was the legal issues were raised, like how a bench sitting in limited review jurisdictions assumed power to frame new questions of law. How Gogoi bench chose to rope in unconnected religious issues in Sabarimala review. But then all this will be done. 9-judge bench dismissed these objections and decided to hear the reference. So this happened on Feb 10, but the order has been released presently. So that's why it is in news. So this is the entire detail of Sabarimala case too. It was since 1991 that Kerala High Court had already given its ruling. It upheld restrictions on women entry. Then in 2016, Supreme Court heard a petition, and in that the ruling finally came in 2018, and it allowed women entry in Sabarimala temple. But then the review petition is pending now till the larger issues are resolved by the 9-judge bench, and then the review will be heard. So though the court ruling is in favor of women entry in Sabarimala temple in Kerala, but it has not been implemented. Even Supreme Court at that time had also suggested or advised that situation is not conducive to women going to Sabarimala temple, and they should avoid it. though the Supreme Court ruling is in favor of that. So that was there. And these are the larger issues. You can see the broad issues. There are seven questions which have been formulated by the five-judge review bench for the nine-judge bench hearing. That what should be the interplay between freedom of religion and right to equality, and whether the right to practice religion is subject to public order, morality, and health, and what are these terms? What do they actually mean? Each of these terms, public order, morality, health. Also, whether constitutional morality is overarching morality in reference to the preamble or is limited by religious beliefs or faiths. So such questions were general larger issues were raised which have to be as answered by the nine judge bench. And it was also questioned what is the extent to which court should entertain PILs questioning religious practices filed by a third person who is not a member of that faith. So this issue was raised that third party who's not even a person of that faith is filing a case. But this is public interest litigation. But then this also was a question formulated for the larger bench to hear, to answer. And whether essential religious practices deserve constitutional protection, or they also are to be looked with the constitutional morality lens. So all these are the issues. The next is Nepal summons Indian envoy over border row. So Nepal summoned the Indian envoy and conveyed Nepal's territorial claims over Kalapani region. It has ended a diplomatic note as such too. So Nepal is protesting construction of a link road that will reduce traveling time from India to the pilgrimage zone of Kailash Mansarovar in China, in Tibet. So Kalapani region is located in the state of Uttarakhand, and Nepal disputes this. And it claims that Kalapani is part of its sovereign territory. So we have a dispute here. So here you can see this is Tibet and this is Kalapani region. So Uttarakhand borders Nepal and this is the Tibetan border. So it's a tri-junction border, you can see. This is Kalapani. So Nepal has two tri-junctions with India and China. So the one in dispute now is Lipuleh in Kalapani at the border of Uttarakhand and Nepal. So in 1816, Sagauli Treaty was signed by Nepal and British India, identifying Kali River as Nepal's boundary with India. But Nepal claims that the river to Kalapani's west is the main Kali, and thus Nepal has territorial rights to it, while India says that a ridge line to Kalapani's east is the border. So Kalapani falls in its territory. So such interpretation differences are there. So Kalapani is a disputed site between India and Nepal. You should remember that. The next is China warns of retaliation over new US visa rule. So China threatened to retaliate against US rule that tightened visa restrictions on Chinese journalists. So escalation of row between India, USA and China continues. China had actually expelled more than a dozen American reporters. So now visa rules are being, made stringent for Chinese journalists. So China has, said that it has also threatened to retaliate further now. So tit for tat continues, and diplomatic tensions continue between USA and China. Foreign journalists who work in China, they receive 1 year visa, which must be renewed. So they have to keep renewing their visas, and now recently they have been given even less than 1 year visas, 6 month visas or so. And USA also in response tightened its visa restrictions, and now China again says it will have it will take action further, tit for tat. So that continues. Then next is 19 killed as Iranian warship is hit by missile in training accident. So one Iranian warship accidentally struck another with a missile during an exercise, and 19 sailors were killed and 15 others wounded. So this is the incident which took place during a training in Gulf of Oman. So this is a Persian Gulf and the Gulf of Oman, and this is a strait. A strait basically in geography is a narrow water body which connects two larger water bodies. So Strait of Hormuz connects Persian Gulf and Gulf of Oman. So it is the route through which about one-fifth of world's oil passes. So it's a very sensitive waterway, and Iran continues to have regular exercises training in this region. And presently, this was an accident which happened, which resulted in this disaster. So basically, you should know about Strait of Hormuz, where is it located? Then next is Mandi linked to e-platform sees 65% rise in count post-lockdown. So this is regarding eNAM, National Agriculture Market. So it's an electronic trading portal all pan-India, which networks the almost 7,000 existing mandis, which are run by APMCs, Agriculture Produce Market Committees. So it has the idea is to create a unified national market for agricultural commodities. So this was launched, eNAM was launched in April 2016. So it idea is to have real-time price discovery based on actual supply and demand. But the progress of eNAM had been slow because many states did not amend their APMC acts to facilitate this. Most farmers were not part of cooperatives because you need to come together so that you can provide bulk quantity of the produce as needed to interested online buyers. And most mandis also did not possess infrastructure to make the most of the platform. But now it is seen during the lockdown, like in a day, 177 more mandis joined the platform. So total number of mandis connected now go to 962. So 65% increase in the number of connected mandis. Mandis are actually wholesale markets, agricultural markets. So they are rising. So you can see by Jan 2019, when the first interstate trade took place, there were only 585 mandis. And now you can see they have increased to 962. So in April 2020, since then they have increased. Before that, they continue to be stagnant at this number. So now presently, because of lockdown, center has also recognized the potential of eNAM in overcoming some of the hurdles of lockdown, and it has introduced some important features too, like a trading module has been produced, which allows farmer producer organizations to trade produce directly from their collection centers without bringing it to the mandis. So earlier it was, the rule is that APMCs are involved, so produce has to be brought to the collection centers, to the mandis. And warehouse based training module has also been included. Now logistics module has been included, so farmer producer organization can actually have this done without having commodity coming to the mandis. And then logistics module is also there, so users can have trackable transport facilities through aggregators with 11 lakh trucks, so that can access can be separately given to transportation logistics as support as such too. So these new features have been included in eNAM by the center. So the user base still is nascent. It is said only 1.66 crore farmers are connected, while there are more than 13 crore farmers in India. But then encouraging sign is that at least farmer producer organizations have been connected. More than 1,000 farmer producer organizations are registered on the platform. So means every farmer of that organization also gets access. So this is eNAM. So it is real time buying and selling. So buyer and the seller are there online. So seller, buyer quotes the price, seller accepts the price, and if matching takes place, settlement takes place, and money is also transferred, goods delivery initiated. So that is eNAM. So for that, farmer, has to register goods and himself at the mandi. So mandi was involved, wholesale markets were involved. Now you don't have to bring your produce to the market, has been the change made. So quality certification has to be given. So there are licensed commissioned agents who give quality certification also. And then the bid is loaded on the website, and then buyers all over India can bid for it. And after buyer accepts the bid, challan is generated. So buyer makes payment also, online payment is made, and farmers are made the, given that amount after deduction of transaction fee. And then goods are then the responsibility of the buyer. He can pick them up as he desires. So this is eNAM. And lastly, you have IPPs seek liquidity window to clear dues. So this is independent power producers. So due to lockdown, they are also suffering liquidity crunch and are seeking liquidity window through a special line of credit by the Power Finance Corporation to DISCOMs, power distribution companies, to clear that the outstanding power bills of 50,000 crore. So the revenue collection by DISCOMs has fallen by as much as 80%. So industry is also closed. So their revenue collection has also been drastically affected. And payments to generators have also, power generators, then come power distributors. So the payment out to generators have crashed correspondingly. So this is the concern being raised, and they are asking for more time. So this is there. So that is it. So if the power distribution companies are given some liquidity, given some credit, then they'll be able to pay to the power producers too. So that's the demand being made. So that is it. Thank you.